The conflict in the Middle East rapidly escalating. Israel unleashes dozens of strikes against Hezbollah targets in southern Lebanon in one of the largest bombardments in the country this year. The attack came shortly after Hezbollah's leader vowed to retaliate following 2 days of deadly blasts in Lebanon that killed 37 people and wounded about 3,000 more. Hezbollah has blamed Israel for blowing up pagers and walkie-talkies used by the group. But as the leader of the militant group promised to fight back, Israeli fighter jets set off sonic booms in a clear display of might.
They assumed or knew that there are more than 4,000 devices and assumed that the 4,000 devices are distributed to Hezbollah's members, brothers and sisters in different units and institutions. When they detonated these pager devices, they were deliberately aiming to kill 4,000 people in 1 minute. War crimes or a declaration of war, you can call it anything, and it deserves those words.
The international community scrambling to find a diplomatic solution to the worsening situation in the Middle East. The White House believes a ceasefire deal between Israel and Hamas would ultimately ease tensions in the region.
Our commitment, obviously, to Israel's security is ironclad. We are unwavering, waving against all Iran-backed threats, including Hezbollah. And what we have said, and I think this is kind of the question that you asked to me, is like the diplomatic resolution is achievable. That's what we still believe. It is urgent, obviously. The conflict along the blue line has gone on for way too long, far too long, and it needs to get to a resolution quickly.
Meanwhile, French President Emmanuel Macron says no one is interested in an escalation, adding the Lebanese people cannot live in fear of an imminent war. The UK also calling for an immediate truce between Israel and Hezbollah.
And we are all very, very clear that we want to see a negotiated political settlement so that Israelis can return to their homes in northern Israel and indeed Lebanese can return to their homes. And that's why tonight I'm calling for an immediate ceasefire from both sides so that we can get to that settlement, that political settlement that's required.
China urges the U.S. to withdraw a mid-range missile system it deployed in the Philippines. The Typhoon system is capable of launching cruise missiles at targets inside mainland China. It was brought to the Philippines earlier this year during joint military exercises of Filipino and American troops. A Reuters report says Washington has no immediate plans to withdraw the mid-range missile system. Reuters sources also said the U.S. and the Philippines are testing whether the Typhoon missile system can be used in the archipelago in the event of a conflict. U.S. President Joe Biden touts his economic achievements a day after the Federal Reserve cut interest rates for the first time in 4 years. Biden spoke at the Economic Club of Washington to summarize the U.S. response to the COVID-19 pandemic and the surge in inflation after Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Many economists had predicted a recession would be needed to lower inflation, but were proven wrong after Biden's policies helped create 16 million jobs and raised wages. But Biden says the work is far from over.
Lower borrowing costs will support economic growth. And it's an important signal from the Federal Reserve to the nation that after repeated interest hikes to cool down inflation, inflation has come back down, and the Fed is switched to lowering rates to keep the country growing. Economy growing. I'm not here to take a victory lap. I'm not here to say a job well done. I'm not here to say we don't have a hell of a lot more work to do. We do have more work to do. But what I am here to speak about is how far we come, how we got here, and most importantly, the foundation that I believe built for a more prosperous and equitable future in America.
It is a big issue for American voters with 7 weeks to go before the November 5 election. A Reuters Ipsos poll shows Donald Trump continues to have the advantage over Democratic rival Kamala Harris on the issue of inflation. The European Union pledging support for regions devastated by severe flooding. European Commission President Ursula von der Leyen says 10 billion euros would be made available for EU cohesion funds with some conditions attached lifted to make the response quicker. She also says that money from the EU Solidarity Fund, which supports member states hit by natural disasters, would be used to rebuild infrastructure. The worst floods to hit Central Europe in at least two decades have caused widespread damage from Romania to Poland and killed at least 24 people. Meanwhile, flood defenses in the historic Polish city of Wrocław appear to be holding firm with no signs of serious damage. Well, let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. We begin in Oregon, where the alleged killer of a Filipino nurse has entered a plea of not guilty.
It was standing room only inside an Oregon courtroom on Monday. Supporters and friends of Filipino-American nurse Melissa Dupain trying to get a glimpse of her accused killer, Bryce Schubert.
Mr. Schubert, are you able to hear us?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I heard him say yes, ma'am. Mr. Schultz.
27-year-old Schubert, appearing via video feed from the Washington County Jail, pleaded not guilty to first-degree murder, kidnapping charges, and second-degree abuse of a corpse. Investigators believe 32-year-old Dupain was killed on the same day she was reported missing on September 4th. 2 days later, Beaverton police arrested Schubert and found Dupain's body. Police said Schubert lived in the same apartment building as Dupain. Prosecutors and investigators have not revealed the motive, and details of the crime remain sealed. Schubert is being held without bail. His next court hearing is scheduled on October 15th.
We're here for the long haul, so the community is getting more and more ready for whatever comes next.
Let's head to a New York court where rapper and music mogul Sean Diddy Combs was denied bail for a second time after he was arrested on sex trafficking and racketeering charges.
Sean Diddy Combs was being held by himself at the special housing unit in the Metropolitan Detention Center in Brooklyn after another judge denied bail Tuesday. Prosecutors had opposed releasing the music superstar on any grounds, saying Combs has attempted to tamper with witnesses and that his access to millions of dollars and an alleged cache of weapons make him a flight risk. Combs' lawyer presented a new bail package Wednesday that includes a restriction on all female visitors to his home who are not family members and limiting all visitors to his Miami properties. His camp also offered a $50 million bond, a surrender of his passport, home detention, and weekly drug testing. Prosecutors say the 54-year-old Combs used his business empire to transport women, as well as male sex workers, across state lines to take part in recorded sexual performances called freak-offs, in which the music mogul would watch and masturbate. Combs faces a sentence of up to life in prison and a minimum of 15 years if convicted of the three felony counts, racketeering, conspiracy, sex trafficking, and transportation to engage in prostitution. Combs' former longtime girlfriend, Cassandra Ventura, a Phil M. R&B singer known as Cassie, accused him in a lawsuit last November of serial physical abuse, sexual slavery, and rape.
And finally, in sports, 6'3" Filipino-Hawaiian Blazin Rosili is set for his boxing debut in Los Angeles.
Pure Pinoy blood, born and raised in Waipahu, Hawaii, and now training out of Las Vegas. Standing at 6'3" and weighing at 160 pounds, Filipino-American middleweight prospect Blazin Rosili is ready to say aloha to the boxing world. On Saturday, the 22-year-old with 6 wins, 5 knockouts, and no losses will take the next step in his career, fighting on CBN Promotion's new blood card at Thunder Studios in Long Beach, California, against Mexican Selim Martinez Gonzalez.
I'm taking whatever fights are necessary for me to be successful. So this is everything to me, you know, not just for myself, but for the Philippines and just the whole entire Filipino community and as well as Hawaii, you know.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. Back to our friends at The Rundown.